Your church's logo is the least important part of your church's marketing strategy. No, I'm not joking. I can't tell you how many dozens of church logos I've seen posted and shared among church creatives looking for feedback in these giant Facebook groups. There seems to be a bit of a hyper obsession about your logo, as if you're expected to communicate your entire vision and culture of your church in a simple mark or a shape. Does McDonald's logo tell you that they sell hamburgers? Does Apple's logo actually say anything about their products? Why have so many of the world's most luxury brands switched to generic, personality-less sans serif logo types instead of the more unique ideas that they had before? Let's talk about it. Welcome to Blackbar. Thanks so much for the Patreons who helped make this video possible. If you want to learn how to support the channel, check out the link in the description below. Hi, I'm Caleb, and before we get anywhere, we need to define what a brand is. A brand is not a logo. These are not interchangeable synonyms. A logo is part of your brand. It's often the first part of your brand that people see, but it's only a tiny piece of it. For example, this is a catalog that I ripped off the internet and photoshopped out the logo that the business is for. It's entirely indecipherable now, right? How could I ever guess whom is trying to sell me these incredible products? Well, no, of course not. This is obviously a Target catalog. But how could you know that? There was no Target logo on there. You knew that because Target has a very strong brand identity. They're very consistent on the colors they use, the fonts they choose, the types of images they choose, even the shapes, spacing, and the language that they use. It's all very intentional and deliberate. It doesn't matter if you're on their website, on their app, reading through their catalogs, or even in their store. Target feels like Target even without the Target. Your brand is a summation of all of these elements. It's the big picture, not just visually, but philosophically, socially. How does the general public think or feel about you? How do you want them to think or feel about you? What do they need to understand about your church? What do they need to be abundantly clear on? These are the questions that start you down the process of developing a recognizable, solid brand. And one good brand is worth 1,000 logos. Who are you and why should I care? Put away that pen tool, drop the color picker, and don't you dare start scrolling through Pinterest. You're never gonna get where you're going if you don't know what direction you're aiming at in the first place. We need to figure out what you're trying to communicate with your brand. I've got 3 questions that I ask in literally every single project that I've done in the past half a decade. It doesn't matter how big or how small, these 3 questions are going to set up the goalpost for you to aim at when you're deciding the visual elements of your brand. If you've been around the channel for a while, you've probably heard this before. Number 1, who is your audience? Get really, really specific. Yes, I know your church is for everybody, but developing what we call a persona, or a singular example of your target demographic, is incredibly important in structuring how you communicate with your brand. We all know who Target's persona is. Middle-class woman pretending to be upper-class woman. Am I wrong? Here's the thing. I am not a middle-class woman, but I still shop at Target sometimes. Identifying a target demographic allows our brand to develop a personality. Don't view your target demographic on a limiter on who your church is for. View it as a personification of how your church speaks. Target is not only for middle-class women, but Target speaks as a middle-class woman. The more targeted you can make your persona, the more personality you can bring to your brand. Be specific, be intentional, and know your audience. Number 2, what should your audience feel when they think about your brand? Keyword here is feel. We're not talking about a specific thought or an idea. We're talking about a feeling, an emotion. Fresh is not an emotion. Exclusive isn't either. Welcoming doesn't fit the bill. I'm talking about happy, calm, comfortable, hopeful, inspired, actual, real, intangible emotions. So much of marketing comes down to whether or not you can get someone to feel something. If you don't know what you're trying to get them to feel, you are always going to fail. There are definitely a number of right answers for this one, but you're gonna wanna make sure you choose the one that is the best focus for your church. Lastly, why should I care? This question sounds as brutal as it's intended to be, as it's often the hardest question to answer. Your church is almost certainly not the only one on the block. In fact, if people are simply looking for ways to better their life, who says the church is the only option that appeals to them? Why should your church be on top of the giant mound of options available to me? What makes you special? What is it about you that makes you unique? What do you have to offer that I can't get anywhere else? Quick tip, if anything that you say could be said of any other church, i.e., we have a wonderful community, which is the first answer I get every time do I talk to a church, you become another forgettable option in the middle of the pack. Find out how you are going to differentiate. If you're having trouble, I would highly suggest checking out Seth Godin's book, Purple Cow. It's a super fast read and a paradigm shifter when it comes to marketing strategy. If you haven't spent the time to answer these three questions yet, pause the dang video. Opening up Illustrator and messing around is not the way to building an effective brand. Prayerfully considering the vision, audience, and direction of your church is by far the most important step of the branding process.
The video will pause to allow you to practice.
All right. Let's talk about how to communicate these elements visually. Putting the plan to pixels. Art is 99% subjective. Design is 99% objective. Design has a goal, an intended message for an intended audience. If the message is not communicated, you have failed. There are a number of ways to communicate with graphic design, but we're gonna focus on three basic elements: typography, color, and layout. Remember, these are not just for your logo, but everything in your brand: your website, business cards, app, slides, whatever. I think of fonts as visual vocal inflections. I can write "I love you" three different ways, and one of them look genuine, one of them look like a threat, and the other feel cold. If you can help it, you should really focus on having one, possibly two fonts that you use for your church's brands. If your church is more traditional, perhaps aimed at an older audience or has a longer history or classical style, a serif font like these is probably a good bet. They're an older, aesthetically more traditional style of typeface, typically viewed as being a bit more formal. If your church is more modern, possibly with a younger audience and a more contemporary atmosphere, a sans serif, like these options, is usually a safe bet. Sans serifs often communicate a more modern aesthetic, a little bit more casual, and obviously a little bit younger. I also encourage you not to go too overboard with an exotic font for your brand. Think about the high fashion brand Saint Laurent. A few years ago, they swapped out their iconic, unique serif logotype for simple white Helvetica on a black background. Bland? Arguably. Boring? Maybe. Endlessly flexible and timeless? Absolutely. Saint Laurent has to come up with an entirely new fashion line every 6 months. The more outlandish and exotic their logo, the greater chance it will clash with whatever it is they're working on at the time. Flashy typefaces are exciting, but incredibly limiting in the long run. The simpler your choice, the longer it will be relevant. Next, let's talk about color. We could almost certainly spend an entire video talking about color theory alone, but let's boil it down to the basics. Humans feel certain things when they see certain colors. These connections can be used to guide your audience's perception of your church's brand. Let's take a quick spin around the color wheel and talk about some options. Red is a powerful color. It conveys strong emotions such as love or anger, and it's also scientifically proven to make you hungry. Go figure. Orange is an exciting color. It's a bit adventurous, it's fun, and it feels almost a little bit outside the norm. Yellow is bright and sunny. It is optimistic and undeniably happy. Green is the color of growth. It is friendly and reliable. Blue is solid. It's trustworthy, honest, and loyal. Purple can be mysterious. It's romantic and intriguing. Obviously, these are pretty massive generalizations, but color theory is backed by some pretty hefty science. And if it didn't work, don't you think we'd see more variety when trying to communicate certain ideas? In addition to making us feel hungry, red also communicates action. It makes us feel impulsive. Have you ever thought about every time you've ever seen the word sale, it's in red? Why is every bank logo either blue or green, colors that communicate growth, stability, and trustworthiness? It's important to note that color combinations have wildly impactful effects on the ideas being communicated. Yellow is generally a happy color, but combine it with black and now we have warning labels. Red and green are both used to symbolize food, but put them together and all anybody can think of is Christmas. Again, we could probably spend a whole video talking about color theory, and we probably will. But in the meantime, I'd highly suggest checking out color.adobe.com. It's a super handy little tool that helps you develop easy color palettes with really intuitive controls. You can even check out other people's color palettes and use them as a launching point. If you have a subscription to Photoshop or Illustrator, you can even export the color palette for use in those programs. If any of these questions or decisions feel difficult or overwhelming, please check out our Blackbar Discord. I'm there as well as many other graphic designers that love doing this and love helping other churches figure this stuff out. We're all in this together. All right, now let's talk about layout. I'm gonna try to boil this down to as simple as I can get it. The more important something is, the more space it needs to breathe. White space, or the empty space around your designs, is an incredibly important part of emphasizing what you're communicating. Do you ever wonder why Apple doesn't fill the entire back of their phones with their logo? It's not just because it feels cleaner, it's because it stands out against the plain background. Your eyes are drawn to the logo because that's what they want you to be looking at. Now, not everything has to have Apple logo levels of importance. Having a little bit less negative space makes things feel more relaxed, comfortable, and approachable. It's kind of a bit of a spectrum. I understand that you want something to feel important, but if 95% of your design is just white blank space, you've probably gone a little bit too far. The same goes for the opposite. If you're trying to cram so much information onto one page, there's not a single part of the screen that my eyes can rest, I'm going to feel a little overwhelmed and likely not want to digest all the information being forced down my throat. By the way, you can also use this trick to make text feel more important. Increasing the tracking, or the space between all the letters, immediately draws attention to whatever you're typing. Just make sure not to do this with lowercase letters, because we both know it just looks kind of weird. Now, once you've made these design decisions, you need to find a way to document them in a way that's easy to understand for anybody else that might be creating materials for your brand. We call this document a brand guideline. They're just about as detailed or generic as you want them to be, but I have found the more specific you can be, the more cohesive everything in your brand will feel. Fortunately, there are hundreds and hundreds of templates available online for you to easily input your logo, font choices, and other elements and create a professional brand guideline that is easy to understand. Now, it is important that you spend the time and the resources to enforce this guideline, especially if there are multiple people at varying skill levels designing for your church. I know it seems kind of silly to fight over a color change or a wrong font, but every deviation weakens the strength of your brand, making it harder for your audience to identify your church at a glance. When you put in the work to build a strong brand, designing elements for your church become insanely easier and faster. Your font choices, colors, general layout practices, everything has already been decided. You can start turning out social media graphics and flyers like there's no tomorrow. In addition, it gives you the freedom to design elements without just slapping your logo on everything so people know for sure who it's from. Target doesn't slap their logo on every single product image on their web store. You don't need to have your logo on your homepage 15 times. If you have a strong brand, it's arguable you don't even need it on there once. Still looks like Target to me. I hope this video was helpful in understanding the importance of a strong brand. Don't get me wrong, a recognizable logo is absolutely valuable, but it's only the tip of the iceberg of the tools that designers can use to communicate the mission and vision of your church to the world around you. Thanks so much for watching this episode of Blackbar. If you haven't already, make sure to check out the Blackbar podcast released every single week where we go more into depth into the topics we talk about in these videos. In addition, if you would like to join the Blackbar volunteer team and help make content or help other struggling churches on our Discord, make sure to check out the link in the description below. Make sure to like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week.